10,000 feet. Mm-hmm. I mean, they can go higher, but with the number of people, 10,000
feet. Can you breathe at 20,000 feet?
Well, 10,000, no problem.
I mean, I can't breathe in Denver. I can only imagine.
21,000 is the highest I've gone. Now, you got to be on oxygen above 15, mm-hmm. but you don't have to have it going out the door. So, suck on oxygen on the way up, door opens, out you go. You know, it's just shy of 2 minutes, so you're mm-hmm. you're okay. Okay, you don't start getting
21,000 feet. How many miles is that?
Well, the easy way to figure it is 6,000 is a nautical mile. So
no, I mean
you're just shy of 4 nautical miles straight up.
Is a nautical mile the same as
5,280 versus 6,000? So pretty close mm-hmm. to statute miles.
So 4 miles.
Yeah, pretty much.
So like from here to.
21, well,
4 miles.
Yeah, I mean, if you can imagine, you know, where we're sitting right now to the Inner Harbor is
1 mile.
So it's 4 times that.
Mm-hmm. Straight down.
So straight down.
Great. I mean,
yeah.
4 miles away, all you see is just landscape. How do you know where to land? How do you control it?
Well, that's a trick. normally you're not jumping from 4 miles up. Mm-hmm. So, you know, in the days of round parachutes, okay, mm-hmm. when that's all they used to have, and that's, you know, what you think of when you think of the paratroopers, you know,
right.
military guys, and they still use those. Spotting, which is determining where the wind is and how far upwind you want to get out, mm-hmm. was a real art, and guys had to be very good about it because under a round canopy, you were at the mercy of the wind.
Right.
Okay. Square canopies, you got a little bit more going for you. You got forward drive under mm-hmm. square canopy. So that's a nice thing. Spotting can still be a problem. Unfortunately, our club gives out awards. One of the awards we give out every year is called the Braille Playboy Award. Braille Playboy is for the guy who spots furthest off the drop zone and makes everybody walk. And right now I'm in contention. And I wasn't too far off. I was about a quarter mile off, but there were other guys on my load that ended up about 2 miles off the drop zone the other day. So that's bad. So the idea is get out of the plane upwind.
Uh-huh.
And when you're in free fall, you're going to drift. When you're under canopy, you have mm-hmm. drive so you can actually turn into the wind mm-hmm. and do what's called holding.
Now, do you have controls on the canopy?
You have full control of the canopy.
So you can shift and move.
Right. You can turn... you can descend faster, mm-hmm. whatever you like.
So. Well, it sounds like you jump with a really fun group of people, and we would like to hear about them right after we come back from this break.
With our skydiver friend, Greg, and we're going to look at some equipment that he uses when he's jumping out of airplanes. So, Greg, let's start with your helmet here. Now, what is this made out of?
Well, this is a Kevlar helmet, bonehead composites. Sort of gives the idea of skydiver humor. We like to put skull and crossbones on things.
Uh-huh.
You have talk about what happens if you should die.
You have scratches on your helmet.
Yeah, and believe it or not, most of this is from in the airplane. And you know, it's a good thing, yeah, because I tend to no hair, so I have no early warning.
How do you get scratches on your helmet? Do you want to tell us something?
Yeah, this thing's good. And every once in a while, you bump into people in the air. This is really not made for, like, hitting the ground.
Okay.
If that happens, this isn't going to help you. And there's little bits and pieces in here. There's a little audible altimeter.
Okay.
The inside, we can set this for different altitudes. And
so that gives
off.
You a sound in your ear to let you know,
mm-hmm.
okay, you need to pull the cord now.
Sometimes you get busy, and normally what you've got going on, if you don't, well, I have this as well, and this is a visual altimeter,
uh-huh.
okay, just a dial type. It's
okay.
good to 18,000 feet.
Mm-hmm.
So what's weird is if you ever go above 18,000 feet,
it doesn't work.
You wonder why it's not working. And it literally straps around your wrist and Okay. Sits on your hand like this. Right. And the nice thing is you can see it right in front of you when you're in free fall. But you get busy sometimes, and if the ditter goes off...
Okay, Greg, you're getting busy. What are you doing? You're falling.
Well, you're jumping with other people, and everybody's grinning and having a good time.
You know? I thought maybe you're like talking and having tea or something.
No, you're just kind of hanging out in the sky, you know, gripping and grinning and having a good time.
Gripping and grinning.
Yeah, pretty much. Mm-hmm. Pretty much.
And your gloves?
Gloves, in case it gets cold outside, and these are real high-tech, you know, tackified receivers gloves that you can buy in any sporting goods store. Mm-hmm. Above 40 degrees, I usually don't wear gloves. It's not cold enough.
Okay.
But below 40, I start putting the gloves on.
So how does the temperature change at, you know, the different altitudes? Wouldn't it be colder as you go up higher?
It does. Usually standard is about 2 degrees C per 1,000 feet. But... Mm-hmm. It varies, and I've had days literally where it was warmer at 10,000 feet than it was on the ground.
Wow.
It happens a lot during the winter time.
Wow.
So it's kind of odd that way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So now what's this stuff?
Well, I got two different parachutes here. This is the one that I've actually owned the longest because this is what I use in my airplane.
Okay.
And you can see it looks just like a chair, and it's a seat pack type parachute.
Mm-hmm.
And basically the entire parachute is packed into the seat. Mm-hmm. You sit on it. And it's a round canopy, and this is for if the plane was on fire or coming apart or whatever, you would jump out, you would grab this handle and pull it.
Mm-hmm.
On the bottom, this cap is the pilot chute, and there's a big coiled up spring in there, and that would pop off of there. It's got fabric on it. The fabric in the breeze gets caught, mm-hmm. pulls out a bridle, which yanks the parachute out of the system.
Okay.
Up the back, and now you're hanging under it just like you think of the paratrooper guys.
Okay. So
this basically is what I wear in the airplane. Mm-hmm. One parachute, one shot. If it doesn't work, well, you know.
Pray on the way down.
Exactly.
Have you ever had to use this one?
I've never had to use this one, no. I just got my senior parachute rigger certificate, so I'm an FAA rigger now, and I can pack this myself. Normally, the repack would be every 120 days, mm-hmm. and you have to go to somebody who's licensed by the FAA.
So you haven't used it. You unpack it.
You inspect it, make sure everything's still happy and good, and then you fold it very carefully and put it back.
All right. Yeah. Well, we're going to take a clip at some skydivers. Take a look at this. Well, that was real interesting. So we were talking about the equipment that skydivers use when they're up in their different planes. And this piece you said was your pilot's one. So this is when you're flying.
Right.
Okay. And what's this one right here,
this,
Graham?
This is a sport parachute, or as we like to call them, a rig. And a sport parachute is a little different than the emergency in mm-hmm. that every time you go out, of course, you're going to deploy something.
Now, can I see how heavy that is?
Sure.
That's got some weight.
Yeah, about 25 pounds.
That's got some weight.
Depends on the size.
Uh-huh.
And this, believe it or not, there's two parachutes in here. One goes from here to here.
Okay.
And one goes from here to here.
The emergency chute.
Emergency chute. Main parachute here.
Okay.
But you can see under here there's a rip cord. Mm-hmm. This rip cord goes all the way around to the front.
Uh-huh.
And is right here.
Okay,
and that just stays in place normally.
And there's a little tag on there, too.
There's a bunch of them, and when you go to Boogies, they usually inspect your gear, and then mm-hmm. they throw a little tag on it just to say
it's been seen. No, I was saying the tag on the back here. Because when you open the flap, it's a little tag.
Oh.
That says, in case of emergency, no.
Yeah, and there's actually warnings on the inside that says, oh, by the way, skydiving can be dangerous. All right. This right here is what the visible part, what's called an automatic activation device.
Okay.
It's a cybernetic device. You set it before you go up. If mm-hmm. for some reason you were passing 700 feet mm-hmm. doing faster than 70 feet per second, mm-hmm. this actually cuts the cord for you. You don't even have to pull the handle.
So it's automatic.
And boom, out it comes.
Boom.
So
wow.
Let's say you hit your head on the way out of the plane, you're unconscious. Mm-hmm. This should work.
So because then you wouldn't be directing your free fall, i.e. your arms out, like, you know,
right.
just in a dead
you're gonna
drop.
You might be tumbling. Yeah.
Okay, all right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
gotcha.
Not ideal, but better to have something open up than nothing.
Okay.
You know. This is actually the main parachute under here, and you mm-hmm. can see it's a little bit different setup. The hook, it's actually a hooked pin in there.
I see.
And the way you deploy this is called a throw-out pilot chute, and you grab this little hacky handle here. So when you're in free fall, you'll see when a guy opens up, he reaches behind and throws something off to his side. And what he's throwing out
is the
is this, and it's a little mini parachute.
Okay. And then that catches.
It catches there.
And it pulls.
And it pulls the bridle.
The chute out. Okay.
And the bridle pulls the pin.
Okay.
And these flaps open up. And this bag comes out. And believe it or not, that bag is holding 150 square feet of canopy in it right now.
Now, how long does it take to get that in inside the bag?
I usually do it in about 15 minutes. I know guys that can get it in there in five, but I'm not interested in packing that fast. Their attitude is 120 miles an hour, something's going to happen. But this is, believe it or not, there's a lot of engineering in here. The lines are all stowed just with plain old, you know, natural rubber bands. And as you as it comes out, they unstow in order, and basically the bag comes off the canopy and poof.
Now, how long can you use a chute?
It varies. Honestly, this is the second canopy I've owned. I got rid of the first one when my ankles were persistently hurting after a day's worth of jumping, and it was telling me I was landing too hard. And so a lot of it is just by the feel of the canopy. As long as there's no damage to a canopy, there are no rules as to how long you can keep it in service.
Now, what do you classify as damage? Is there a minute tear in there?
Tears. If there really was something that was not repairable, then you would probably not want to jump.
So if there was a small tear, you'd get it fixed.
You can patch it.
Okay.
Yeah, and that's not a problem. And every once in a while, you know, a guy comes down, you know, off the field, and maybe he snags on a barbed wire fence or something like that. He gets a small tear. No big deal. Guy can patch it up.
Okay.
And you're back in business.
James, have you ever done this? Have you ever jumped out of a plane?